Luminova, SuperLuminova, Lumibright, Chromalight. We hear these names often, but how are they different? Or is there any difference at all? In this video, we will do a deep dive into Luminova, SuperLuminova, from what they are to how the many variants of it differ from one another. This is going to be a massive one, so let's get going. Before we start, one quick note. Our channel aims to put out high-quality, well-informed videos on watches and watchmaking. If you like our content, please consider liking and subscribing. It helps us tremendously. Now back to the video. To talk about what Luminova is, we have to go way back in time, to when Lume can actually kill you. Back then, Lume was made with radium paint. It may seem shocking to you now, but they actually thought radium was an energetic substance with health benefits. So they went with it for a while until the radium girls discovered some jaw-dropping reality about radioactivity. But that's a story for a whole nother video. So companies started switching to other less dangerous substances, like promethium and later tritium, which still exists in some forms nowadays. This is a good point to introduce how these old Lume substances work. They work thanks to a magical chemical called zinc sulfide. It has the ability to absorb light and then re-emit it as light. This is phosphorus in a nutshell. But the downside of zinc sulfide is that it cannot keep emitting light for very long. Solution? You mix it with radioactive substance, so it has a constant source of energy intake and gives out a constant glow. We can illustrate this with a UV flashlight. Just imagine this is the radioactive substance. As long as I keep the light on, the Lume pigment will glow indefinitely. That's why one of the advantages of tritium tubes nowadays is that it always glows. So the reason why they switched to promethium and tritium was that while they are still radioactive, the radiation they emit is weaker and less harmful compared to radium. The underlying formula stays the same, zinc sulfide plus radioactive substance. But the problem remains, it's still radioactive. Not only is it still a health hazard, radioactivity also causes irreversible damage on the phosphorus substance over time, reducing the luminous ability as the watch ages. That's why those Rolexes from the 60s often no longer have functional Lume. Be careful with these defunct Lume though, they're still radioactive. It is against this backdrop that Luminova comes into our story. We'll go to the land of the rising sun, Japan. Nemoto & Co. was founded by Kenzo Nemoto in 1941 as a manufacturer of luminous paint. The major breakthrough came in 1993, when Nemoto & Co. discovered the luminescence property of strontium aluminate. This is Luminova. The secret sauce is doping the phosphor with a trace amount of impurity, in this case with the rare earth ions europium and dysprosium. Not only does this newly discovered chemical absorb light and glow in the dark, it also does this with 10 times the brightness and 10 times the duration of the status quo compound zinc sulfide. This eliminates the need to incorporate radioactive elements, as now the newly discovered formula can hold sufficient charge to glow through the night, plus being brighter while doing so. Since then, strontium aluminate has become the de facto standard for Lume. The majority of best performing proprietary Lume formulas nowadays, be it Seiko's Lumibright, Rolex's Chromalight, or Noctilumina, are based on strontium aluminate. At this point, we're still talking about Luminova. What about SuperLuminova? In 1998, Nemoto established a joint venture with RC Tritech called Luminova AG Switzerland to manufacture Swiss Lume products. This is the birth of SuperLuminova. It's still more or less the same basic formulation at this point, but SuperLuminova is 100% Swiss made, and it aims to be a high-performance luminous product. Since then, SuperLuminova has debuted some innovations over the years, like more afterglow variations other than the default green and aqua afterglow, and higher grades of Lume pigments, more on them later. And it remains the pinnacle of Lume performance. But make no mistake, Nemoto's Luminova series is still one of the best you can get on the market. Now let's talk about the factors that influence the Lume performance of different Luminova products. You might have heard that C3 is the brightest. That is true. But why? Turns out, they stand for the color of the Lume pigment. Luminova is manufactured by baking a raw material. When it gets baked, it comes out as a greenish color by default. This is C3. Any other color that you see is achieved by adding colorants. These colorants absorb light, so it limits how much light the phosphor absorbs and releases. This is most evident in the color red. We can simulate this by putting a red acrylic sheet over the Lume pigment. We can see that the glow is heavily dimmed. It being red means that it absorbs mostly blue and green light, which are the colors emitted by the Lume pigment. Other colors absorb light in a different part of the spectrum, but no matter what color it is, it only absorbs light. Therefore, adding colorants only dampens the glow, and consequently all the colors other than C3 have only reduced Lume performance compared to C3. That's why it's true that C3 is indeed the brightest. BGW9 is another color that's worth mentioning. It is the second brightest formula behind C3. It differs from C3 in the way that it naturally emits an aqua light and has a white body in daylight, as opposed to the yellow-green body of C3. And that might be more appealing to some designs. In terms of Lume performance, compared to C3, it has a slightly weaker Lume strength, about 5% in reduction. But it fares better in low light conditions due to the Purkinje effect, which states that the human eyes are more sensitive to the color blue as illumination level decreases. So BGW9, with its aqua emission, is a better choice for low light conditions. This set of characteristics does ring a bell, doesn't it? Blue afterglow, long duration. Doesn't that sound like Rolex's Chromalight? Does that mean Chromalight is another name for BGW9? Let's go to the source to find out. On the 2008 Rolex Deep Sea, the watch that debuted Chromalight, they claim that the Chromalight hour markers and hands are filled or coated with a luminescence material emitting a long-lasting blue glow for up to 2 hours longer than traditional phosphorant materials. So it has a blue glow, and the selling point is its longevity. And evidently, it has a white body in daylight. Sounds like BGW9. In addition, this is Rolex's press release in 2021 on Chromalight. Quote, "The luminescent material begins life as an ultra-fine powder containing aluminum, strontium, dysprosium, and europium." So strontium aluminate doped with europium and dysprosium? Basically the same formula as BGW9. To finish off the comparison, there's a great Lume comparison video on YouTube you can see for yourself. The video shows that the Rolex Chromalight basically performs more or less similar as the watch with BGW9. Link in the description if you want to see it for yourself. Let us protect ourselves from Rolex lawyers by pointing out that this is just all speculation. But it never hurts to learn more about these products, right? But there might still be a reason why Rolex claims to have a superior product. Besides the choice of color, one of the deciding factors of Lume performance is grade. SuperLuminova comes in different grades. Take C3 as an example. There are standard grade, grade A, and grade X1. X1 is the best performing grade, followed by grade A, and then standard grade. On Tritech's website, it is stated that grade X1 shows a performance increase of up to 60% after 2 hours compared to the standard grade. So yeah, higher grade, better performance, of course, but in what way exactly? To understand the differences, we need to understand this curve. This is a decay curve of a luminous substance. On the x-axis, we have time, and on the y-axis, we have brightness. On most luminous products, a decay curve will look like this, starting off at a certain initial brightness and decreasing exponentially until it's essentially dead. To make this curve more useful, we'll add a horizontal line here, which is 39 nanocandela, the minimum visibility level for naked human eyes according to ISO standard. When the curve crosses this line, it is considered no longer visible. This is how you get the figure for how long it will last in the dark in those marketing materials. For us, we're interested in two numbers. First, the initial brightness. The higher the starting point of the curve, the brighter it is. Second, the duration of the Lume. The longer, the better. Alright, now we can understand this graph from Tritech comparing performance with 1 mg of each grade applied. We can observe that the higher the grade, the flatter the decay curve is. And that suggests the higher grade is indeed better. Let's look at the two numbers we're interested in. First, the initial brightness. Although this graph does not go to the very beginning of the curve, we can see that the curves do start with them bunched up together. This suggests that grade X1, grade A, and standard lume should have more or less similar initial brightness. The significant difference is with the second number, the duration. While the standard grade C3 goes under the visibility level under 3 hours, the grade X1 glows for more than 4 hours. This is more significant if we consider the graph with 4 mg of superluminova applied, which reflects the usual practice more appropriately. We can see that the grade X1 glows 12 hours while the standard grade dies at 8 hours. That's 4 hours of difference and a 50% improvement. So that covers most of the stuff you need to know about Luminova. Now you know what it is and what affects its performance. Comment down below if there's anything more you want to know about Lume. We'll cover them in a future video. But the Lume pigment is only one part of the equation. In fact, you can have two watches with SuperLuminova C3 grade X1 and their Lume performance can still differ dramatically. There are many more factors that influence the performance of the Lume, and they are what separate the great Lume from the okay Lume. And in the next video, we detail all these tricks so that you know how to maximize brightness when you lume your watch. As you can see, the amount of research and work that goes into each of our videos is immense. If you appreciate our work, please subscribe and hit the bell icon. That'll help our channel immensely. That's it for this video, and until next time, have fun with your watch.